Jesus poured the sugar weakness in the street becomes our own. Don't you think even like you, though the being white, bringing beauty from ashes, you will have the right. Free of all her guilt, it got rid of all her shame. And nobody else would pay. And it's why I seek your praise. Never be on my lips. Never be on my lips. Your praise. Never be on my lips. Never be on my lips. Your praise. Never be on my lips. Never be on my lips. Your praise.
Appreciate y'all coming out and just supporting this band. See, y'all just worship with us. We do good things for y'all.
You are, and I know that. Stay standing if you would. If you just bow your head, close your eyes right where you are, I just want you to ask yourself this question. He is a good, good Father, amen?
Amen.
But is He your Father? We hear this a lot in a lot of our professional, I'll call them professional Christians. They say we're all God's children. That's not true, because we're not all God's children. We're all God's creation. We don't become His child until we invite His Son into our life to be our personal Savior.
Amen.
You know what I do know is that we come to a place and there's a great crowd and we can get lost in that. We get lost in the music and the worship and the things. Scripture teaches us that there is no other name given among men by which you must be saved. He's not a good way. He's not the best way. Ladies and gentlemen, according to Scripture, John 14:6, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. He is the only way. On this day, He's the only way to heaven. And so I just want you to know that there's already been one saved this morning before we ever even got started. So the door's wide open for you. And I just want to ask you, is He your Father? What a great song. He's a good, good Father. But with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, and we're not even going to do anything other than just ask that question right now. But that question is He your Father? And the only way He is He has to be born again. Scripture teaches that whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And every person in this room, no matter what you look like on the outside, how much you have or don't have, where you came from or who your parents were, you are a whosoever. A buddy of mine was at a funeral yesterday and had a shirt on that said, I'm a whosoever. And I want you to know that the Scripture is talking to you when it says, whosoever that calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You may say, Chris, you don't know what I've done. It don't even matter what I know, and it sure don't matter what you've done, because the Lord Jesus will take you just like you are.
Amen.
And His grace is sufficient. Father, in Jesus' name, may we be very clear. May we open the Word of God. Lord, I pray that I would never share this Bible and make it boring. Lord, I just pray that you would help us to realize, Lord, this book is alive and it is full of life. And it is life because it contains the life, the Word of God, your Word. Draw us right now, Father. I pray your will be done. We're so thankful for men like Renovate who love Jesus. Carry us to the throne. What a song. He's a good, good Father. And you are, Lord, a good, good Father. And so I'm asking you right now that you'd help us to realize, Lord, there's a blessed hope in front of us. There's an opportunity we're going to have one day to go see the Father. There's an opportunity because we're saved that one day when we draw our last breath here, it'll be our first breath in heaven. May we never get over that. May we never get to a point where it's just mundane and routine. Lord, may we realize that when we get to be in your presence, every day and every moment is special. Father, I pray you bless this time in Christ's name. Amen. We are in the book of Titus, going through a series called Back to the Basics. If you'll take your Bibles and turn there, Titus chapter 2 is where we are today. And we ended last week with the last verse in chapter 1 that told us we profess to know God, but by the things that we do and by our works, we deny that we know God. Christian is a general term that so many people use. Man, you need to know the Lord. Oh, I'm Christian. When did you get saved? I've always been saved. I'm a little facetious sometimes, but when somebody tells me they go to so-and-so's church or go to a certain church, I always ask them, man, yeah, who's the pastor? And if they are stumbling around to find out who the pastor is, I'm just going to promise something. They don't go. They hadn't been in a while. How about that? And then sometimes they'll tell you more than you want to know. But anyway, when we move to chapter 2, we see some clear instructions for those that have been in the faith for a long time. Did you know that if you've been saved for a while, that you still have a job to do to deliberately lead people who are new Christians, people who are watching your life? You never get to a point where you retire on God. Those that need to be taught by those that are brand new. And we have to learn that how we talk or who we talk with. The scripture tells us what to do, but the people of God, they literally show people how to follow the scriptures. If I tell you, you ought to be kind to your brother, then I ought to model kindness. If I say you ought to turn the cheek when somebody does you wrong, when somebody does me wrong, I need to make sure I turn the cheek. I've got to share this, Daniel, because you're here today. What an incredible guitar player. This guy can play. All these guys can play, right? Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Amen. In fact, I'll even rephrase that. People say, well, give the Lord a hand. Hey, give these guys a hand. They're using their talent for the Lord. That's what I'm talking about. He works in the tag office. And all these guys, they were doing rehearsal this morning. I got to look up here at them. I said, every one of these guys can be played with anybody at any time, anywhere. And they've got great talent. But as I look at them, one of them works for the phone company, and one works for the tag office, one works at a supply house, one owns a music store, one works at Royston Corporation. They got people that they get up in the morning and they go. And he made a statement to me that made sense. I said, you know, the people who minister to people the best are the people that relate to people that are relational. He said, well, the gospel is relational. And I thought that was Jesus. He was relational. But if I'm going to teach somebody how to turn the other cheek, if I'm going to teach somebody how to respond in difficult situations, they're going to watch my life to see if I'm responding right. 2 years or a year ago, I got a new truck. Didn't get a new one, but I got a truck. Since I had the one I'd had for 17 years, this was new to me, even though it had 240,000 miles on it. I drove it like it's brand new. Well, I got the truck, and there was a few things wrong with it, so he knocked it off the price. I was so happy. He said, you need to go get the tag for it. I said, I'll go get the tag for it. Remember, it'd been 17 years since I'd owned the truck. Or since I bought another truck. I went to the tag office, of which Daniel works at the tag office. I didn't know Daniel at the time. And I knew he looked familiar. That's just it. Am I saying something wrong? Harry? Danny, I said Daniel. Well, I'm calling him. Hey, when you're talking about tag men, I'm being very official right now. You understand that? Because I felt like I was in the lines then. You all right? So Danny's back there, and he waits on me. He walks up to the counter, and I said, I gave him my stuff. I need to get a new tag for this truck. I just purchased this from so-and-so. He said, it'll be $786. I lost my joy quick. You understand that? In fact, I thought he was kidding. I thought, but God, I hope he's kidding. I said, it's $786? Yeah. He didn't even break a grin. I said, what are you talking about, $786? He said, well, you got to pay the ad valorem up front now. Remember, it's been 17 years since I bought a truck. And I'm going to tell you, I lost my joy. I ain't lying, I lost my joy. I remember, and I was thinking in my mind, I said, I don't know who this guy is, but I got to make sure I keep it in check. Because I don't know if I'm going to blow this place up. If I'm just going to break down and cry. But something's got to happen. There's got to be an emotion over this news right here. I remember going, I had to go back to the bank and get more money. To get a tag, no? I came, I paid it. I tried to be gracious and nice and everything. I came home, I complained to everybody I saw. Things kind of settled down that night. All I could think about was, I hope I didn't lose my testimony in front of that guy. Then I realized he played with David's group. I thought, in the name of Jesus. I promise you, if you preach it, you're going to get an opportunity to live it. And you say, well, I'm glad I'm not a pastor. I'm just talking about if you proclaim it, you're going to get an opportunity. I love the story. I don't know how true it is, but I can see it's happening to me. Guy rolls up at a stoplight, had a bumper sticker, says, honk if you love Jesus. The guy behind him honked. He shot him a bird. Here's the moral of that story. Don't put a bumper sticker on your truck. That's what I'm saying. See, here's the thing. There are some that will say, I want to follow God. But here's how they're going to follow. How are they going to know how to follow God? They're going to watch your life. They're going to watch everything about your life, and they're going to say, if he's doing it, I'm doing it. If you come to the local church and they give you an opportunity to hang out with the boys and they're hanging out over here and they're telling dirty jokes, before long, if you're a brand new Christian, you think it's okay. You're over here telling them. If you give them a place to smoke, they'll smoke with you. If you give them a place to do this, they'll do this with you. Why? Because they're watching what we do. And the scripture even teaches in Titus, when he told Titus to go to the land of Crete, he said, I want you to go there and I want you to fix some things that are messed up. And here are some things that are messed up. And he has a word to the older men, the older women, the younger men, the younger women, and even to the bond servants. So there's a lot of list here, and I want to labor that because I want to get to verse 11, talking about the grace. Because I want you to understand something. I'm so thankful. There are people say, I'm glad I don't have any rules and all these do's and don'ts. Let me tell you something. I don't care how long you've been saved. You still got rules and lists of do's and don'ts. The scripture still talks about things you should do and things you shouldn't do. It's still there. But I'll be honest with you. We serve a perfect God, a perfect scripture. We're imperfect people. So how in the world do we score? How in the world do we pass the test? Grace. Grace is not an opportunity for us to say, well, I'm going to sin because I got grace. See, if there are no role models in your life, we have a hard time learning how to walk with God. In our society, we have a lack of male role models in the home. 68% of this generation is raised by their grandparents. Daddy's not around. And listen, that don't matter what color you are or where you're born, south, north, whatever. Bottom line is, daddies are escaping the responsibility. And when they escape, nobody is growing our young boys up to become young men. And we wonder why we have such a problem in our nation, because nobody is staying up. Nobody is standing up and say, listen, follow me as I follow God. I'll be honest with you, as a Christian man, my job, first of all, is to instruct my family. And then, hopefully, there may be something left for somebody else. Paul is instructing Titus to tell the older to teach the younger. You know, here's the thing, and maybe you do or maybe you don't realize that the coming of the Lord is going to happen, but all of this is preparing us to get ready for the coming of the Lord. He said, by the way you act, people are going to watch you. And as they watch you, it helps them prepare to get ready for Christ to come back. So Paul is instructing Titus. For the person who does not know the Lord, the day of the Lord is a tragic event. For somebody that has never embodied Christ in their life, for somebody who has never been saved, for somebody who has never surrendered their life to Christ, we talk about this blessed hope. We talk about the day of the Lord. We talk about the Lord coming back to get his church. And when you hear that, when that happens, that's going to be a tragic day for you if you don't know Christ. But for the person who knows Jesus, it is the beginning of your eternal life. In fact, when you got saved, it was. But this is the whole other level. The attorney you always thought about and heaven you always thought of, this is the beginning of it. But as for you, in verse number 1, he's telling Titus, but as for you, speak the things which are proper for sound doctrine. Let's read a couple of verses, several verses first of all, and we'll stop, preach a little bit, and we'll go back and read some more. Begin with verse 1. You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. You therefore must endure hardship. Now wait a minute, just stop right there. This is a guy who is following the Lord, who is following Paul, and he says in verse 3, you therefore, talking about Titus, you must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. So just as a reminder, when you walk with God, it is not a time that you get out to the point and say, whew, I'm glad I don't suffer anymore. Listen, the closer you walk to God, suffering is inevitable. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. A lady told me this morning, she said, pray for the devil to get off of me. I said, I'll pray for you if you'll pray for me. She looked at me and she said, I can't find my teeth. Yep. I said, you think the devil's got them? I think he did something with them. You know what it is? The little things in it. It's not major things where the house explodes. It's the little things. I can't do this. I can't do that. But he gives them a few words. Look at verse 4. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, but he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. Look at verse 5. And also, if anyone competes in athletics, and I'm in the wrong. Yeah. I know I told you I turned to Titus. I'm like, this ain't sounding a bit like I'm supposed to be right here. The air blew my page over here. You don't mind if I just start over today? Renovate, come on up here. We're going to start all over again. I was reading, you know, I'm just trying to be cool about it. I'm thinking, this ain't sounding right. God, you might have to take over. I don't feel like I'm connecting today. Well, there's a reason, Scooter, you wouldn't. How about that? I gave you 5 minutes free. How about that? All right. Somebody said, I'm going to read chapter 2 of Titus. Oh, this makes more sense. For you, speak the things which are proper for sound doctrine. That's the time of it this week. Look at verse 2. The older men be sober, reverent, temperate, sound in faith, in love. Likewise, that they be reverent in behavior, not slanderers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things. That they admonish the young women to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, homemakers, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God may not be blasphemed. Likewise, exhort the young men to be sober-minded, in all things showing yourself to be a pattern of good works and doctrine, showing integrity, reverence, and incorruptibility. Sound speech that cannot be condemned, that one who is an opponent may be ashamed, having nothing evil to say to you or of you. Exhort bondservants to be obedient to their own masters, to be well-pleasing in all things, not answering back, not pilfering, not showing all good, but showing all good fidelity, that they may adorn the doctrine of God, our Savior, in all things. So, several things said. First of all, there's a word to the older men. I'm not just going to spend the time on every one of these, but he gives us a list of things for the older men to be. First of all, he uses the word sober. And literally the word sober means to be in control of your mind. You literally need to be at the point where you're saying, when somebody is drunk with wine, the wine sometimes doing the talking and doing the acting. But when he's talking about being sober-minded, he said, you ought to be in control of what God is doing in your life. Here's what happens. If we've been saved for a long time, it's real easy for us in our latter days as a Christian to get lazy. It's real easy to get to the point and say, you know what? I used to be on fire. I used to do this. But you know what? And what he's saying, when he says being sober-minded, he says, don't get lazy. Then he uses the word reverence. In other words, don't have loose speech. And the literal word reverent literally means to grow up. Somebody says, well, I don't like to be all serious and everything. I don't know about you, but I've been around some people a lot older than me. And they say something like this, well, he or she has earned the right to say that. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't care if you're 150. If it's not in the Bible, if it's not godly, you have not earned the right to say that. We still live by the same set of rules as day one. But he says, there's a time to have fun, there's a time to be serious. And Jay Stratton used to say this statement, there has got to be a day when the little boy sits down and the man stands up. For some of our men, for some of you, it is time for you to take a step of faith, time for you to take a step up and say, you know what? I am, for the first time maybe in my marriage, I'm going to be the leader of my home. That's your job. Your job is to deliver your home. And then the second, another word he uses is the word temperate. It means to be in control. It means y'all not go off the handle. It means to be in control. Then he uses the phrase sound in their faith. Here's what he's saying. By this time in your life, you've walked with God long enough that you should be sound in your faith, not wishy-washy, not bumping back and forth. You need to know what you believe, and you need to practice what it is that you believe. Sound in the faith. Then he uses two other things. In love, as you get older, you ought to love people more. Well, I see the opposite a lot of times. In patience, not impatience, but in patience. As an older man, we've learned sometimes, or we need to learn sometimes, to be a little bit more patient. Because you know what? As you grow a little older, you realize things don't always happen like you had them planned. They don't. You've seen enough by experience to realize, hey, things aren't really panning out like I thought. Patience. And so what he's saying is, I want you to teach the younger men some things. Now, Paul had given the responsibility to the women of Crete also. So there's a laundry list there. He says in verse 3, to the older women likewise, they be reverent in their behavior. You know what? The word reverence carries two meanings there. It carries the meaning of not always being loud and boisterous, being seen, but it also carries the phrase of be careful what you wear, your dress. Wow. To the older women, he says. Now, I don't know what they're wearing that day, but in like manner, in 1 Timothy 2:9 says this, in like manner also the women adorn themselves in modest apparel with propriety and moderation, not with braided hair or gold or pearls or costly clothing, but what is preached is proper for women professing godliness with good works. Now, what some of you are saying? All right, let's take off all the jewelry. Let's unbraid the hair. Let's take off all the makeup. No, I am a fan of painting the barn if the barn needs painting. Amen. Ladies, paint the barn. You ain't got to put it on the putty knife, but you can paint it. I can tell you that. I had to share that with somebody. See, when we get to this verse, we have a lot of controversy. What women should wear, jewelry, listen, that we're not talking about being legalistic, but here's what it is saying. You should dress to where you attract someone to God, not attract someone to you. You've got to be careful that we don't market ourselves. And see, here's what they're saying. They're saying, young ladies, how are you going to learn how that you ought and ought not to? You're going to watch those who have been here a while. You're going to watch them. And here's the thing. If you're 60, you ought not dress like you're 16. That's all I'm going to say about that, all right? He says, don't be a slanderer. It means don't gossip. Ephesians 4:29, let's say, no communication come out of your mouth. But that which is edifying to those that hear it, that might minister, listen to this, grace. It's what you're going to. I used to have a lady in the church here, and she'd be popping, bop, 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 and I'd say, hey, now listen, don't be doing it. She said, if it's the truth, it ain't gossip. Did it encourage anybody? She felt good. But not slanderous. Then he says this, not to give into much wine. Y'all not be any cough medicine, ladies. All of a sudden, they've been doing this study. They've been doing things their way all this time. And this little guy named Titus is going to come up and tell him, hey, some things fix the change around here. There's a new sheriff in town. Paul put me in charge. They're thinking, uh-huh. That's what you think, big boy. These women have been in charge for a while. But there's also a word to the younger women. Look at verse 4. That they admonish the young women to do what? A couple of things. Number one, love your husbands and love your children. You know what I've learned? If you have kids, and this is not a sermon on parenting, and I'm not considered an expert on parenting, but I will tell you this. If everybody else is wanting to beat your young ones, you ought to be the first one to do it. That's all I'm saying. You said, is that biblical? Yeah, Proverbs 13:24 says, he who spares his rod hates his son, but he who loves him disciplines him promptly. That means light him up. Oh, I just like to camp out there, but I'm not. Amen. Here's what he's saying. Learn from people who are in front of you. Learn from people who have been there. Younger women, learn from the older women. Younger guys, learn from the older guys. He uses several things to be discreet. You don't always have to be seen. He uses the word chaste. Not only in act, but also in look and speech and thought. The word means holy. He used the word homemaker. That means you can't have a job. Here's what it means, ladies. Your job is to make sure that you set the tone and the atmosphere for your home. God says in His Word, all through His Word, homemaker doesn't mean, I can't do anything, but a society we live in, we've created such a need, we've created such a thing where we got people working everywhere. But here's what He's saying. You need to be the thermostat of your home, not the thermometer. You need to set the temperature. You need to be the one who sets the atmosphere of your home. Because you know what? As your kids grow up, they're going to learn how to respect authority based on how they see you respect authority in your home. So I tell you one thing, you think I'm going to be submissive, you're crazy. You better tear it out of your Bible because it's in there. It doesn't mean that you're second class. What it does mean is that everybody has a lane. And a house that's out of one, some people are out of their lane. And when you get out of your lane, here's the thing, I love my wife, I really do. She was coming out. I mean, I'm serious. I remember. No joke. No, this ain't no tale about it. We was going out of the house last night. We were going to the fireman to Christmas bank. She's all pretty good. I kind of said, well, you look pretty. You are pretty. She's kind of rolled her eyes. She said, why do you? I said, why do you always roll your eyes when I say that? Well, you don't want really things that. I said, I'm on what matters. Get you some. Yeah. Glory. You know what? Me and your job is not to have a lane here. Ladies, you have a lane here. Guys, you have a lane here. It's to say, you know what? I know where the Lord is. But see, there is nobody that is more strong-willed than my wife. She is. I mean, that's the way God made her. Okay? Now, here's the thing. She said, I bet she's not submissive. Well, I had to whoop her into shape. She got there. Took me a while. I've been married 29 years. Y'all all right? But ladies who are independent, ladies who are literally have a drive, are sometimes they say, oh, I can't be myself. Oh, yes, you can. That's why you married the man that you married, is because you're not supposed to work in competition. You're supposed to work as a partnership to say, I'm going to make her better. She's going to make me better. And if we'll stay in our lane, our house can have harmony. The thermostat in our house will read that there is harmony in the house. But if we're always saying, I'll do my own, I don't care what you do, we got problems in the house. See, there are a lot of variables in our society when it comes to the family. But just because there are a lot of variables doesn't mean that the standard has changed. There's a lot of variables. We don't live in the same world we did back in 1940, but we still serve the same God, and we still read the same Bible who was written by men of God when they were moved on by the Holy Spirit. This is the standard. Like it or not, if it fits your world or not, this is the standard, and nothing can take the place of the Word of God. Nothing. See, he even says that we do this so we don't blaspheme the Word of God. We literally have the ability to blaspheme the Word. What is blaspheming the Word of God? Just say, oh, that ain't that big a deal by the way that we live our life. Well, he had a word to the younger men. He said to be sober-minded. In other words, be in control of your emotions. He says also in verse 7, in all things, allow yourself to be a pattern of good works. Wow. In other words, your standard, your everyday walk with God ought to be good. You ought not just have a good day, but you ought to be a good person according to the Word of God. And there are days you might have a bad day, but a good day ought to be a surprise. You ought to be about good works. Verse 8, sound speech that cannot be condemned. I can tell you something. Somebody said, well, my daddy taught me to say what's on my mind. It's not a good thing. Sometimes you just don't need to say nothing. Verse 9, and he also talks about the bondservants. A person who serves, they don't get paid, but somebody had to pay the price for them to be their servant. It's the picture of our walk with God. It's the same picture. But showing all good fidelity, that they may adorn the doctrine of God, our Savior, in all things. In other words, your life ought to line up with what you say you are. Your life ought to be that. Your life ought to be a picture of what it's like to walk with God. He said, you ought to walk with God, then your life ought to be an example of that. Look at verse 11. Here's where I want to finish. It says, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age. Looking for the blessed hope. Maybe, ladies and gentlemen, I am looking for the blessed hope. Amen? And glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purity for himself. His own special people, zealous for good works, speak these things, exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no one despise you. There's a word about grace. Several things he says, and I just want you to listen because there's a lot of information, and we'll get to the kind of the climax in just a minute, but I want you just to hear a few things. First of all, the grace of God is defined. Saving grace is the unmerited eternal salvation of God, which comes freely to the believing sinner as a gift for the atonement of Jesus Christ. It is receiving the opposite of what we deserve. Wow. What does a sinner deserve? Condemnation and hell. If you got what you deserved, if I got what I deserved, every one of us would be in hell today. I was at a funeral of Miss Betty Duncan yesterday. But Tommy Duncan walked in. Me and Jerry Clemens were standing there. Tommy Duncan leaned down. He said, boys, I'm going to tell you what. If God hadn't straightened us out, I wouldn't even make it to this place right here. I'd already been dead and gone. I thought, you know what? Thank God he straightened you out. Amen, Tommy? Because the stories I heard, that was a crooked stick right there, that's all I'm saying. But you know what? None of us are too far gone. The grace of God can't change our life. The grace of God defined. Salvation by grace means salvation is not attained or maintained by human works. Rather, it is the free gift from God through faith in Christ's blood. Listen to this. Not only is the grace of God defined, but the grace of God is disclosed. The word salvation means deliverance from sin and its consequences. Secondly, the grace of God is available to all men, not just a select few. There is things that are bumping around here and say, well, you can't get saved. God didn't choose you. Well, what does the scripture say? Look what the scripture says in 1 Timothy 2, verse 4. Who desires all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. 2 Peter 3, 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Listen, even though it is not his will that any should perish, his grace doesn't save all men. Because grace doesn't save all men, but it provides a means of salvation. Because you still got a choice. When you choose not to follow God, guess what? We can talk about the grace is free, but if you walk away from it and say, I don't want none of that, then we can talk about grace all we want to. You're not just going to save because of grace. Grace is the means of how you're going to be saved. Say, well, I go to a great church. Won't help you. I tell you what will help you is when you accept that free gift. When you accept it. In fact, let me do something right quick. George, come here just a minute. Now, I didn't tell you this earlier, but I got a brand new truck out there. Brand new. And I want you to know I had you on my mind this week, and I went and bought it for you. And I checked what colors you like, and I got that. Checked Leanne. She told me all that kind of stuff. And I just want you to know it don't cost you a thing. I've already paid the insurance for a year. I've already paid that blame tag, though. I've done it all. Okay? Guess what? Right now, I still have a truck. There's keys to the record. I just got one question for you. Does that truck become George's truck? You getting that? I can talk about truck all day long. I can talk about how good that truck is. But if I'm just talking about it and he's just hearing about it, but he didn't step out and receive the grace to receive the truck, guess what? It's just a story. And I'm going to tell you something. Those are just keys. There's not a new truck out there. Somebody said, I hope he chooses me next. He said, prove this. Well, let's look at John chapter 3, verse 16 through 18 and then verse 36. I just want you to sit and hear this. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent his Son, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believes on him is not condemned. Listen to this. But he that believes not is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Listen to verse 36. He that believes on the Son hath everlasting life. He that believes not on the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides in him. Salvation from the penalty of sin is yours if you accept Jesus Christ as personal Savior and Lord. You may be bringing your kids to church and say, man, I just want to get my family in church. And that all sounds good. But you getting your family in church still won't get you to heaven. You trying to do better now than you used to. You start to read the Bible like you've never done before. You start to not cuss like you used to do. You're not drinking like you. All those things are great things, but those things won't put you in heaven. The only thing that will put you in heaven is the shed blood of Jesus Christ. That's it. And we can tell you the good news all day long, but until you receive it, it's just good news. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, behold, the new creature. Old things have passed away. It is so simple. The grace of God is so simple for you to step out and just receive it. But if you never take the grace that's offered to you, it's just grace here, you're there. No connection. But when you say, you know what? I want that. I want that grace. Here's what he's teaching. He's teaching us that we should live righteously and godly. There's a salvation from the power of sin. Thirdly, there's a salvation in the presence of sin. He says in verse 13, looking for the blessed hope, the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Ladies and gentlemen, have you ever sat and thought just for a minute that the blessed hope we always talk about, that we always think about, we sing about, we preach about, in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, everything will change? He said, well, I'll tell you what, I want to make sure that I'm right before then. Did a funeral yesterday with John, and every stone in that burial, in that area, had two dates on it. Every stone had a date that they were born and a date that they passed. But there was something else that every person, that every one of us can relate to that's in that graveyard, and that's the dash in the middle. Can I tell you something? We're living in the dash. We're living in that time where we're saying, what I'm doing right now, when you listen, if you're waiting till you get a second date on your tombstone, it's going to be too late. You got to make a decision to follow God. Man. Looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great Savior, Lord Jesus Christ. There's a great day coming for those who are born again. There's a blessed hope coming for those who know the Lord. What a day it's going to be. You know what? I want to share just a video with you in closing. And but while he's ready, but I want to give you this, just this scripture. 1 Corinthians 15, beginning with verse 51. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. At the last trumpet. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Look at verse 55. O death, where is your sting? O grave, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, talking about us, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Let me clearly say this. At the rapture, we will be saved from the presence of sin. The old sin nature will be forever removed. We will be untemptable. There will be neither a desire of sin nor an ability to sin. Watch this screen.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word became flesh and the light shined among.
Salvation from the possession of sin. Bible says in verse 14, it says, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purity for himself, his own special people, zealous for good works. There's something called the doctrine of substitution. You say, how can somebody dying literally take away the sins of people who need somebody to be in their place? And the answer is it can't if that person who is in substitute is of the same nature and same type as the person whose needs redeemed. Ladies and gentlemen, when the baby was born in the manger, he was fully God. When the baby walked as a man, he was fully God. When the baby hung on the cross, he was fully God. When the baby returned to heaven, he was fully God. And ladies and gentlemen, when he comes one day to receive us that glorious day, he is fully God. I'm going to tell you, the Lord Jesus is coming, man. I don't know exactly when or how, what's going to like. Aiden Rogers says, when he comes, I'm going to be on the welcoming committee, not the program committee. And I understand that. There's a lot of theories, a lot of thoughts out there in the scripture. Well, I get confused. I'm going to be real honest with you. I know this, though. I know that the opportunity for me to know Christ is going to be before I see him. And if you've never met Christ, or if there's doubt in your life that you even know Christ, if there's never been a time when you've surrendered, not that you've been to church, not that you've prayed, not that you've joined a church, been baptized, or done the motions, but if there's never been a time where the Spirit of God has drawn you to himself and you have said, Lord, I confess that I'm a sinner. I surrender my life. Would you change me for all eternity? If you have never surrendered your life to Christ, listen to me, ladies and gentlemen. You need to do that because we don't know when he will appear. But he's going to appear. And only those that know him, only those that are looking for him. My mom and dad have a mutual friend. His name's Tommy Merrick. Tommy has a brother-in-law that was real hard, wouldn't get saved. And one day he went to church finally with his wife. When he went to church, the preacher preached on the second coming of Christ. And how two would be sleeping, one would be left, one would be taken. Two would be in the field, one would be left, one would be taken. And that Sunday afternoon, he had thought about that message. He came home. And when he came home, everybody had dinner, and he went to bed, or he went to sleep on the couch, took a nap for 5 hours, woke up, and nobody was there. The car was still in the driveway. The TV was still on, and nobody was there. Think about, two will be sleeping, one will be taken, one will be left. We'll be in the field working, won't be taken, won't be left. All you think about, I've been left behind. Tim LaHaye wrote a series of books called Left Behind, and you've read that one. But I'm going to tell you something. And it gets personal and say, you know what? If that were to happen, if it were to happen today, would you know, would you be left behind? I'm going to tell you, there is a blessed hope only for those who know Jesus. You know, July the 31st, 1984, God changed my life. And since that day, for 32 years, listen, I didn't have to have religion. I didn't have to do anything but realize that on that night, even though for 32 years I feel like I've done more wrong than I've done right, but since that night, on a Tuesday night, 1984, when God changed my life, listen, I have never, ever in my life, since that day, doubted the fact if I died, I'm going to heaven. You know why? Because on that night, God changed my life. And I've never been the same. And I'm going to tell you something. They start talking about the rapture, and I hear John talking about it. He's going, woo! I don't know what it's going to be like on that day. But I'm going to tell you something. You can't get all excited about the second coming of the Lord, John, unless you're ready for the second coming of the Lord. And I'm going to tell you something. If you say, well, I think we shouldn't talk about stuff like that scares me. I said, you got a problem. Because everything we do is getting us ready for the Lord's return. I don't know what it's going to look like, as I said. I know they've been saying it ever since I've been alive. But I know this, we're closer today than we were yesterday. And all I know is I want to be ready, man. I want to stay. I want to be, not that I got to perform. Thank God I don't have to perform because it's built on God's provision, not performance. Thank God for that. But I'm going to tell you something. I'm thankful for grace, but I'm going to tell you something. If you don't know Christ, there's a lot of people that are professing one thing, but their lives, as Titus 1 says, their lives paint a different picture. And he's always saying, if you're going to be saved, you're going to act saved. You're going to say you're saved, you're going to talk saved, you're going to walk saved. You can have people say, there's something different about you. Something different. Just having the form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. They call it slap that rain. Hey, it'll be because I put God in my life 32 years ago. Okay. Your head's bowed, your eyes are closed. Very, very. friends, but I know if you're sitting here and somebody talks about them one day, it either excites you or it scares you to death. If it excites you, man, I'm going to tell you what a glorious day it's going to be. If it scares you to death, maybe you need to do some work with God. Maybe you need to change, but maybe you need to say, God, I need some things need to change. Romans 10:13 says, for whosoever that calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Jesus said in John 14, he says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life, and no man comes to the Father but by me. You know the greatest thing about grace is he'll take you just like you are. Baggage and all, man. But he loves you too much to leave you that way. All the stuff you've done, all the junk, he'll take it. All you got to do is come dump it at the cross, he'll take it. And the ground at the cross is level. He loves you. So if you're here this morning and you've never trusted Christ, I'm going to pray out loud and ask you to pray in your heart, and then these guys are going to sing. And we'll give you an opportunity to respond to that. If you're sitting there and you say, Chris, if I died, I don't know for sure I'd go to heaven, but I'd like to. You can pray this in your heart as I pray it aloud. Say, Lord Jesus, would you forgive me of my sins? The best way I know how, I need a change. Would you forgive me of my sins? Come into my heart and make me new. I want to be that new creature. 2 Corinthians 5:17 talks about it. And this morning, ask you to come to my heart, forgive me, save me. Once and for all and forever, I want you to change my life this morning. In Jesus' name. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Nobody's going to come to you, point you out, and embarrass you. But you be honest. Not that you're going to be perfect, but you be honest with your and raise your hand and say, listen, pray for me. Because today I prayed that prayer, and I do want God to change my life. Would you just take your hand up and straight up in the air? Thank you. Thank you. I do want God to change my life. Others who would raise your hand and say, listen, pray for me. Thank you. Others would say, hey, pray for me. Our counselors are, they need to be ready because there's some people who need to respond this morning. But I got to tell you something. If you embody Christ in your heart, you prayed that prayer. I'm not going off this platform to come after you. Nobody in this church is. But I want to just talk to you just a minute. If you raised your hand right where you were, right where you're seated, would you just look up here at me? I'm not coming after you. I just want to talk to you. Did you mean it with all your heart? Did you? Amen. Did you mean with all your heart? Yeah. Did you mean with all your heart? Amen. Here's the thing. Here's how simple the gospel is. The simplicity of the gospel is to say, you know what? I'm headed this way. I invited Christ to come in my life to change me. I'm going to make a bow face and go the other way. That's it. You say, well, I don't know if I can live it. No, I'm going to tell you you can't. Not without him you can't. You're in trouble. But I'm going to tell you something. Jesus Christ loves you so much that they can just like you are. And he'll say, Chris, come to me. And he'll walk with me. That old song, and he walks with me and he talks with me. And he tells me that I am his own. Wow. Hey, sir. I don't care what your family situation is. Let me tell you what you need to do. You need to get this part of your life right. Because nothing else will make sense until this happens first. I'm going to pray. We're going to stand. And if you prayed that prayer, Denise and John are going to be standing right here. Megan's going to be standing right here. Terry's going to be down here. And you may need to come to somebody and say, listen, I prayed that prayer. Just four words. I prayed that prayer. Simple as that. They just want to wrap their arms around you and love on you and thank God for you. Because you're the reason we're here this morning. You're going to do what we do. Father, in Jesus' name, draw us to yourself. And we'll praise you for it. For everything you do for us. Thank you for these hands that were raised. Now, Father, I pray you give us freedom to step out of the seat. Come to one of these staff and say, I prayed that prayer. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together as they sing. You come. Don't wait right now. Just step out and come right now. Thank you. Amen. You purify. Just for the men. I want those men, just that acoustic, these men, just to sing that again. David, would you lead our men, just our men, sing that, and you're a good, good father.
Cause you're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am.
Just for a second, just got a couple of announcements. Our ushers, if you would get ready, we're going to receive an offering before renovate. Like I said, they're all local. So, well, what kind of expenses they got? We love them. We're going to take care of them. And let me challenge you. Take care of them well. But I'm thankful to God. I was talking to David. Danny, I'm so thankful for you. I really love these guys. But, you know, you're kind of the new guy that came in since you've been here last thing, right? And the heart that you guys have, just the heart for God. And that, honestly, that's more than the sound. And I appreciate the spirit that God's got on your life. Help me thank Renovate for leading us. Denise got some down. I want to do this very quickly, and then that way, I have been told that I can share this. Thank you, buddy. I've been told I can share this, barring any rain or whatever. Okay, so here we go. Yeah, I'm not going to tell you anything other than next Saturday morning at 8 o'clock, we're going to start driving nails, all right? You said, well, I've heard it before. I have too, bless God. I'm tired of hearing it myself, all right? And I've been the one saying it. But we will pour this week, and our first welding will go up starting next Saturday. Okay, so if you can help, you say, well, I don't know anything about building. Well, we're going to need breakfast and we're going to need lunch. Okay, so if you can do breakfast or lunch, sandwiches, biscuits, something, come see me. Okay, as soon as I say amen, these guys get out here, come see me. Got to make sure we got enough food for these guys and ladies. This is not just a men's project, this is all project. Okay, we start, and here's the thing, once we start, it's going to be ongoing, all right? So we start next Saturday morning at 8 o'clock. Also, men, this coming Thursday night at 6:30 at the Sportsman Gun Club over in Bowman, we will be having our Iron Sharpens Iron. We're cranking it back up after the holidays, and we'd love to see you there. And that's all I got. He's got the others.
All right. I don't want to miss this. I actually stand up right there where you are. So...